Hey everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas and our one more week of special guest, Paulo, Vitor, Damo Doritos. Today we're doing hit or myth, guys. For Paulo, who's never done this before, and the five people that haven't seen this before, we're just going to take a look at the mythic rares that were in Dark Ascension and kind of say whether or not we thought
they were a hit, good, or a myth, bad. not even bad, like, power level-wise, just shouldn't have been mythic. We're combining power, flavor, splashiness, just all these things. Just, you know, should this card be a mythic? And then, as suggested by Aaron Forsyth, we actually have a slightly different take on the end, which is normal rares that we think maybe should have been mythic.
Could have been.
Or would have been good. Would have been good mythics.
Yeah, in one way or another. I mean, maybe a slight power tweak, or maybe just could have been mythic.
Yeah.
So starting, actually, I don't really know how this list was arranged, but we'll go with...
Go by the list.
Moonveil Dragon is a mythic rare.
Yeah, this is a myth for me. Like, I really, really loathe the, like, rare dragon that does something, you know, neat.
Something.
Because it's not that I need mythics to be constructed playable to be mythic. We've gone over this, but... It does suck that their dragons, which are like kind of the coolest part of Magic, or one of the coolest parts, right? They're one of the iconic figures of Magic, are just never good recently. Like, the last playable dragon was like Champion's Block or something?
Broodmaid?
Sure. But like, or maybe a Hellkite, whatever, but I guess that was way before Broodmaid. But these dragons just haven't been close to being good recently. And it would be nice to see like an actually constructed playable dragon that would get a chance to, because they all feel the same to me. This is a fire-breathing dragon.
Yeah, they're all 6-mana 5/5. Yeah, I think it's a myth, though. Like, if it was, like, John, Demon Fair Dragon, or whatever.
He needs a more special
name. If it was, like,
name.
A legend and did something a little bit better. Yeah, if it was, like, a bullet different card.
All your guys have fire breathing. Sure, that's, like, an uncommon enchantment.
They're all the same. They're all 6-mana 5/5 fires with an ability to, like, either pump something or lets you attack again or deals damage to creatures.
Yeah, some sort of fire-related ability, whether it's fire breathing, whatever.
Actually all the same, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to try to defend it. I mean, I
good luck.
I know, right? Like, I think that every set at this point, you're going to see a card similar to this, and it's going to fill in a mythic rare spot. I think the best you can hope for is make it legendary, make it do something really unique, maybe not make it red.
Well, the thing is, you can make a dragon, and it can be red, and it can cost 6. It feels like they could have a cooler ability, though. A more, maybe, unique ability. Like, yes, the dragons breathe fire. We understand that. Dragons breathe fire, but...
Yeah. I mean, it is a mythic that is just like every other card they print. It's like they reprint it. They reprint it every set.
Yeah.
That doesn't feel mythic.
I mean, is this that much cooler than Shivan Dragon? When you're fire breathing a giant flyer, do you need to fire breathe your like Llanowar Elf also?
All right, it's a myth. I tried to defend it. Let's move on to Hell Vault here.
Hell Vault's kind of cool. The one L is kind of weird though. I guess they didn't want to actually spell
what?
It's spelled H-E-L Vault instead of Hell Vault. But I guess that maybe it would be too awkward to actually have Hell on it.
I think this is a big myth.
Really?
Is that the stone?
It's It's like one mana to cast.
You can hide your guys, similar to like Safe Haven, which was a land.
Yeah, it's like 3 to cast, right? And it costs one
to
tap to
exile your own guy.
7 tap exile theirs, but so when it dies, okay. They all come back.
Okay.
So it's kind of like, you know, Spine of Ishtar, your opponent's
it's
guy.
It's a combination of Cold Storage and Predator Flagship, to put in terminology that most people won't understand.
Right. I went Safe Haven. You'll go a little bit. You'll bring it to 2,000. We'll bring it to there.
Yeah.
I don't feel like it's mythic, though. Like, if you put these cards together, does that jamming two rares together at high speed make a mythic rare?
I mean, I think it's a hit for me, because as far as I know, in the story, it's where, like, Avacyn is imprisoned.
Yeah.
So it is important. It's like... something that...
All right, I mean, you're bringing the story in there. I didn't think Paulo was going to bring the story.
It is
story
a unique thing. Yeah. Like, it makes it, like, one item. There's only one in the world, and...
Okay.
I don't know if it is. It should be.
I don't know, but either way, I think it's actually a hit, just because, first of all, it's called Hell Vault, which is kind of cool. And second of all, what it does mechanically makes a lot of sense. It traps guys in it, and then maybe it'll blow up and they'll escape, maybe they won't, or angels in this case, and I don't know, I kind of like it. I think it's a cool mythic.
Okay, let's move on to Beguiler of Wills.
Let's make sure we all disagree, because so far it's...
it's been 2-1 each other way.
Yeah. We're probably going to agree on this one. Right?
Such a miss.
This is a myth, right? Like,
a 1/1 for 5. What does it do? It might gain control of something, maybe.
Yeah.
It is a very cool card, I think.
But
it is not. Does not feel mythic to
me. It's very interesting to see the Paulo scale of cool and the Paulo scale of playability are vastly different.
Well, I mean, it is completely unplayable.
Yeah. I mean, his scale of playability is just binary. So, like, we've already figured that out.
Every card we've talked about so far is completely unplayable.
Not, I mean, this guy's well,
not,
like...
not yet. We'll see.
This guy's even, like, a windmill slam in draft.
Oh, he is very good in draft.
He's an insane windmill slam in draft.
Okay.
He's a hit there, but he, when I see this, I didn't... If you told me this was, like, an uncommon, I'd think, okay, that's messed up for draft. They wouldn't do that. If you told me it was rare, I'd be like, yeah, of course it's rare. Why would it be a mythic? It does not evoke mythic in any way, shape, or form to me.
It's not legendary. It doesn't even have decent power and toughness. Like, what if this card had been, like, an 06 or something? Like,
it still wouldn't be mythic.
Yeah.
Okay. That was quick, easy, and... uniform agree. Let's move on to Archangel's Light.
Is that just shuffle your graveyard, gain to life?
Yeah, 8 mana, Ancestor Chosen, plus shuffle all your graveyard back. It's cool, but I don't know. I guess if I think Reverse the Sands should have been mythic, which I kind of do, this feels kind of mythic to me, too.
This doesn't feel mythic to me.
The rare Knot of the Bone?
Yeah. It doesn't do anything.
What if this card costs 3 mana?
Well, then it'd be insane. They're not going to print it at 3. Like,
it could cost 7. We'd be very safe at 7.
We would at 6. It would be good though.
I mean, how much does the ancestors or whatever it cost? The amount of flashback.
Ancestral Tribute.
7, like, then 9, right?
It's like double white and 5 the first time.
And then 7, then 9, but I mean at 6 mana, this card would have been very good. I think. I don't know, in an Esper deck, you cast and gain 20 life.
Sure. I would say very. It would be playable.
Yeah, right now it's not, though. The fact that it makes successive ones weaker is kind of bad in Constructed.
Yeah.
In Limited, I think
it's just completely unplayable in Constructed.
Yes. It's a 0. There's a 1 or a 0, and it's a 0.
Single white and 7, it being, this is pretty much a casual format card.
Louis wants to play it in draft.
I do. I think it's a good draft. It's excellent.
And okay.
You don't need a win condition. All you need is this.
So
just deck them with these. Just gain life. You need a second way to shuffle them in. Maybe just 2 of them.
Just two of them.
Maybe that's why it's mythic. They didn't want you playing 2 of them.
Yeah, it'd be too broken.
So in that regard, hit.
Yeah.
Ultimately,
I'm still going to go with myth, though.
Yeah.
I agree. I mean, I think that this is closer in my book. This one's a closer call, but universal myth here.
You see the light.
Let's talk Elbrus, the Binding. Binding.
Oh, yeah, this guy's definite hit. I mean, this guy's awesome.
What
this
is it? I don't know any names.
It's a 7 casting cost equipment. You
this
pay
turns
one
into a
two.
Demon.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Home run.
Yeah.
I mean, this card's amazing.
It's insane. Like,
yeah, definitely a hit.
I'm a little sad that I suspect I will never be putting 13 counters on the demon, but I think the fact that it's a blade that turns into a demon, it's the perfect, like, you know, living weapon sort of thing. Like, it's really cool. Like,
yeah, no, definitely a hit.
Paulo can actually attest, when it was spoiled, but before we had the picture, every day I'd go look to see if the picture was there.
Yeah.
Because I wanted to see what it looked like, because it would look sweet to me. This card's awesome. It's one of my favorite cards in the set, I think.
Yeah, it's pretty good. It's like the Lich, the artifact one.
Nefarious Lich or whatever. Or not Nefarious, the
Phylactery
Lich, yeah. It's just one of the most...
This is very cool, yeah.
Very evocative cards.
Goes back to, like, RPGs and stuff.
Yeah.
Clear home run.
Yeah.
Clear home run. How about Machias the Unhallowed?
Yeah. Hit.
I mean,
I agree. Hit. It's legendary. It has a very unique ability. It plays on a previous set storyline.
I think I have
no idea Paulo is so into until right now. Storyline matters.
Okay. Other than, like, playability, I think he's a hit on everything, which makes him a hit for me.
My biggest problem with him is you can have the two Machiases in play. Like, I don't know if I've explained this before, but the fact that you can have Machias the Lunark and Machias Unhallowed in play is really disturbing. Like, clear oversight.
I think the Wizards is clearly trying to prevent this from happening as much as possible, keeping them both mythic.
So that's true. There's less of them for the people who generally care about such things.
Right. So the flavor draft police do not come around.
Okay. I'll admit this is a hit.
Thank you.
That if they fix that, it would be much better though.
So how about that new Vengevine Vorpede?
While we're on Machias, not completely unplayable. Machias Triskelion, instant win. Bam. Mm. That is not irrelevant. I mean, it makes tooth and nail a kill in Modern. It means in maybe Legacy you could assemble a good piece.
Sure.
But anyway,
I haven't thought of that.
Move on to
Vorpede, the new Vengevine. One was mythic. This should be mythic, right?
No, I think that neither of them should be mythic. This is a myth for me. Like,
is that the Undying big guy?
Yeah, it's the big your Timmy-esque
myth.
I'm just not thrilled with these, like, I don't know, kind of dorky insects that do things.
I mean,
like,
he's a fine rare.
Yeah, he is a fine rare.
That's it.
He might be above. I mean, again, you have to define what's the curve, the average for rare. What's the curve, the average for mythics?
I mean, just who's this exciting to? It's not a particularly cool card. It's not a particularly flavorful card. It's not even a particularly good card, right?
It doesn't hit on any aspect.
Yeah,
like there's no story, no flavor, no playability.
No story, no flavor.
It's also not. It's not like huge, you know. Like if
you had gone way upstairs with this card, made it 9 mana and like a 10/10 or something.
Well, like
if
it's enough of a thing to me.
No, but like at least then like it would appeal to people who get excited about such things. Whereas this is small enough that like it's intended to be played as like a mid-range value card, which first of all no one gets excited about, and second of all is just not good at.
4 and 5 casting cost creatures are always the most exciting.
Yeah. Too expensive for constructed, not cool enough for like, you know, your formats like EDH game, or whatever.
Miss. Hith, Myth, etc. Falconwrath, Aristocrat.
Oh, the new giant Solfuge?
Yes.
I actually kind of like this. I think, I mean, she plays well with Olivia. Like, they both, like, fit the same like, flavor niche, and they both, you know, they're like vampirist lords that, you know, feed on humans in one way or the other. I think it's kind of cool.
I don't know. I think it's a myth for me, but not by much. Like, if I would choose a rarity, I would choose rare, but I'm not outraged that it's mythic. Yeah. Like, I'm just fine with it.
I think it's unique enough. I mean, it's a 4/1. Like, you're going to get counters and make it, you know, indestructible is kind of that ability that's like fringe mythic. Like, you know, you're going to find it on very overcosted rares and uncommons.
It has no name, though. Yeah. It should have a name.
The lesson here is you put legend on anything, and Paul's like, mythic.
Yeah.
Hit. Yes, it doesn't have a name, and I agree that mythics feels like they should be named more than not, but I think this is a hit. I think like Paulo, I'm very close. Like, he's like slightly below, I'm slightly above, but I think it's a hit.
I'm gonna go with hit here eventually.
I think TSG breaker here.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with hit on this one. Right. Again, as we get deeper in this list, you're gonna see it's harder to try to like. Well, then you gotta go to the other side. You gotta make rares mythic. Like, if this card isn't good enough, this other card isn't good enough. It's like
there are some swaps I would probably make with rares and mythics, but given that this is mythic, I'm fine with that.
Agreed. Then we've got the Drag School Reaver.
Oh. Yeah, I'm not really feeling it. This card is kind of meh.
Which one is that?
It's the double striking lifelink one, wherever you gain life, draw a card.
Yes. I had actually forgotten as we were. Okay.
It's the seven mana.
Every time you gain life, you can draw a card.
Yeah. Yay.
Again, Drog Skull Reaver is one of those names that it just means nothing to me. Like,
right. Yeah, it could be a 2/2 for two.
Yeah, it evokes no. I hear that and I get no anticipation of what the card could be or how cool it could be.
I mean, if I had to guess the colors, I would guess first black, then like black red.
what's that like vanilla
Drog Skull Reaver?
Yeah,
what's that like, vanilla 4/3 from Shards Block for 5 or whatever?
Drag Reaver?
Drag Reaver?
Yeah. I read the card, I'm thinking like, what's this?
It's not a good name.
It is not a good name.
Or a good card, but.
Yeah, or, both those things.
Let's make it a 2/6, so it lives through Dismember. Jeez.
It was still, 7 mana is a lot. Like, the bar for 7 is very high, I think.
Yeah, I mean, Elesh Norn, like, that costs 7. Titans cost 6, like, Karn. Cost 7. Like, these are the cards that I want to be casting.
I don't want to be casting Karn, but
I do. In Modern.
The Saving Grace, I mean, yes, I think it's a myth here, but the Saving Grace was that, you know, gain life, draw a card. That's a very unique ability. Double strike lifelink.
If it had a name, and it was a lifelink.
It would still be a myth.
And you could weave it into the story. You understood why it was there. All right.
It feels like Pure Heart Avenger instead of Drog Skull Reaver.
Yes.
This guy, he might have a name. Huntmaster of the Fells.
Oh yeah, this is a hit for me. This card does enough things and is cool enough that I think this is I'm fine with mythics being at this level.
You're really kind of maximizing flip cards. Yeah. You're doing about as much as you can. You're putting tokens into play, you're gaining life, you're dealing damage, you're making things happen when it goes to either side. You can't ask much more from flip cards.
Yeah, if you have a, you know, they all try to have like a flagship of whatever their theme is.
Yeah.
And this feels like an appropriate flagship. It's very obviously pushed pretty far. Like, I'm not saying it's the best card ever, but it does a lot of things, and it keeps doing these things. It feels like they're like, let's make a really awesome flip card, and I think they did. I think this is a hit.
I think it's good, a hit for me too. Yeah. Not super exciting like the sword, but still a myth.
Like, if you had a name.
A hit.
If you had a name.
Yeah.
if he was like,
it just looks like there are many hunt masters, you know.
What I don't like, though, while we're on the subject, is you flip over to the backside of the werewolves, just take the picture out and shuffle them up, and I just like probably couldn't tell you which one was which.
What is the name on the backside?
Yeah, it's not on
Ravager
the list.
Ravager of the Fells, I believe.
Oh.
See, it's set reviewing me. You gotta get... I just get all the names. Yeah. But
it's a hit. It's a hit for me.
It is a hit, but yeah, the werewolf pictures in general are not hits for me. They all look like just werewolves. I don't know.
Yeah.
What did you want out of werewolf cards?
Unique werewolves.
Yeah. Maybe with like a top hat or a monocle. A civilized scholar of werewolves.
We're getting into the meat here. Yeah. Haven Ghoul Lich seems like a home run.
Yeah. A hit for me.
Yeah, I mean, I like Drownu, and this guy feels like a lich and feels like this is where liches should be, you know, arcane spellcaster, like, reanimates things, undead, gains abilities, like, it does some pretty cool things. Pretty ghoul things, if you will.
It seems pretty simple. I mean, it's a gold card, it does something very unique in the game, it gains activated abilities, puts things in the back, and it allows you to cast them. It's all-encompassing for what I kind of want to
do. It's the new Necrotic Ooze. Conley's going to be playing it at Worlds.
Softballs.
I mean, I like liches. Liches don't have to go very far for me to like them.
Yeah, liches are very
liches
cool.
Are just very cool.
It's a little bit of a bias here. I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah, but I mean, it worked. I mean,
okay.
I mean, it's a bias because they're cool.
Yeah.
Well, the last one's real easy. We've got the Lone Planeswalker, the Sorin, you know, Lord of Innistrad here.
Maybe if he had a more unique name.
It was already a Sorin.
His name is Sorin, Lord of Innistrad. That is pretty cool. And he's also a planeswalker that does pretty cool things. And yeah, he fits mechanically pretty well. He's a little aggressive for my tastes. I don't know.
They have lifelink. Or is it too aggressive for you?
The middle ability.
You wish it was like plus 0, plus 1?
That would be not very good. Okay, yeah. I mean, this is a very...
Castle emblem. Like when you're untapped, to gain plus 0, plus 2.
Ooh, yeah. The castle emblem would be nice. Have like a 1-7 level vampires.
It's a hit.
Yeah, easy hit. The triple vindicates over the top. Like that.
Yeah, it is a very weird ability. I don't see where you're going to use it. Because if they have a bunch of guys, and then they're killing Sorin.
Well, it's just if you have Sorin on like 7.
Sorin, and then they play it like a big guy, yeah.
No. They play Grave Titan, and you kill him and gain control of both tokens.
So I think the last question with Sorin is, when was the last time a Planeswalker wasn't a hit at Mythic?
They're always going
to
be.
They have to do a pretty bad job of making them to make them not be a hit.
Yeah, it would need to be like Planeswalker with one ability or something.
I mean, all their Planeswalkers have been awesome. Even the ones that don't end up seeing that much play have been pretty sweet. Like, they have good flavor just naturally. They're naturally just like these individuals that are like, very cool, and they have a bunch of abilities. And again, even the ones that aren't good have cool abilities.
Like, yeah, I mean, they always feel mythic.
Yeah. So Planeswalkers, I mean... There, you know, some people don't like the complexity they bring, the power they bring, the fact that they're all expensive, generally, at least when they come out, and sometimes later. But I think Planeswalkers were great for Magic, and I think one of the reasons they are is because they always feel mythic. Yeah. Mythic rares make sense when you look at Planeswalkers, like, completely.
Lastly, we have they could have been mythic. Cards ended up just being rare. I think that the obvious surface one from this list for this set was Zombie Apocalypse.
Yeah, come on.
It feels very mythic, like a super event.
Insanely mythic. Like almost as mythic as any other card that would be on the list.
Almost like a Planeswalker.
And it's funny, this is such a rare circumstance because, again,
Zombie Apocalypse? Yeah, it does not happen very often.
I always look at the spoiler and you see a mythic rare and you just like, I kind of like snap like, oh, there's another rare. Another rare got spoiled. Like the dragon's a good example of that's a rare. This card had the very unique experience of the other way around. I saw the card without looking at the rarity. I was like, oh, sweet mythic.
Yeah.
Not a mythic.
Yeah. The only good thing about it not being a mythic, though, is I get to see it more often. And I get to cast Zombie Apocalypse and make Zombie Apocalypse noises. Brains.
Thalia, Garden of Thraben, also seems like it could have been mythic here. Again, it's a legendary creature with a legendary name.
It's so small, though. I mean, it could be mythic. I wouldn't be, again, outraged if it was mythic, but I think it's fine as a rare.
On the Paulo scale of, I'm not sure which scale this is, but not outrage seems like a pretty positive
this
review.
Is the kind of legend that it's only legendary because you don't want two in play. Not because it actually makes sense for it to be legendary. Like,
yeah,
it's like Cammy of the Moon or whatever. The like 1/3 guy that's hauling mine.
Yeah. Yes.
It's just a very inexpressive card. And
yeah, I mean, I agree. Part of the reason it's legendary probably is because it would be very obnoxious if your opponent's on the play and has
turn two, turn three,
then you can't cast or think twice or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, But yeah, I would have liked to see this be mythic, but
I'm indifferent. Yeah. I'm fine with it.
Would have indifference. That's pretty good so far. I mean, there are some like wish didn't even get printed. But it's like, well, we're happy with this. The last from my own personal list, I think, again, you can just kind of tweak the cards a little bit, but something that gets so much talk and I think really helps for mythics in a set is excitement around the set and, again, unique to the flavor, unique to the story. So much talk about Jar of Eyeballs. I mean, it's not like, it's power level as printed isn't like super high. But again, it's so much, I mean, instantly, like, what about the one-eyed scarecrow, Luis? I don't understand. How does it get two counters? Yeah.
Giant spider, 8 counters.
Yeah, exactly. It would be mythic, except for these problems.
Again, you should make it mythic so we run into them less often. So Luis just goes and grabs the D20 every time he sacks a spider.
Exactly. I would actually be fine with this being mythic and make it a little better, or as Paul said, a lot better.
No, I'm...
Not pay 3
I thought it wasn't coming. Until right now, I thought it wasn't coming. It's just so much like Crystal Ball to me, and Crystal Ball is uncommon.
Or Serum Tank from like Mirrodin, kind of like.
Yeah, it just feels uncommon to me.
It does feel uncommon.
Not even rare, let alone mythic.
How about
it's of course very unplayable.
Yeah, that's a given.
As printed, yes. I'm saying it's so full of flavor that if you just kind of adjust the numbers a little
bit. If it could be like a unique artifact or something that does something. Yeah, if it could be like a lot better, then it could be mythic.
Yeah, a lot better.
Could like mythic. Okay. I mean, imagine if you take the name. And you take the eyeball kind of mechanic, and then you change everything else, and you make it very good. Then it could be mythic. But I mean, I think
every time you cast a blue spell, you put a counter on it, and then tap it.
I like the like creature dying and the eye counters. You just have to make the rest a lot better.
Yeah, it's hard to make this kind of card flavorful and good. Yeah, because having creatures die as a requirement already makes it pretty bad.
Yes.
And what it does is just not very good.
Yeah.
I mean, you could maybe remove as many counters as you want. It would be a lot better. It's still unplayable, but
okay, right now zero, you have one.
To. Yeah, this is definitely zero. Right now you have to remove all of them. It's just very bad.
Yeah, I mean sometimes you gotta crack open your jar of eyeballs.
Yeah. Can I get one ball?
Yeah.
Do I have to get all of them?
Use a toothpick.
Yeah.
As opposed to just dumping them out.
Yeah.
See, oh yeah, these things feel mythic. Again, if we just increased the power level.
Yeah. Okay, the flavor. Is cool enough that we would have liked to see it be a cool mythic. The mechanics of the card make it feel uncommon, that I can agree with.
And this is why we don't make magic cards.
But I would have made a sweet zombie apocalypse.
apparently they agreed because it's rare, it's not uncommon or mythic. So there's probably like two people fighting, this should be uncommon, it should be mythic.
Right? Yeah.
Compromise or rare.
Exactly.
We're better than this than I thought. Thank you, Paulo. Any other parting words here? Hit or myth for Dark Ascension?
I'm overall not too unhappy with how the mythics ended up. Like, no. I think it's not as much like necessarily how the numbers broke down, but I think some of the cool ones are pretty cool. The biggest problem to me is that the zombie apocalypse wasn't mythic. I think that's the biggest like oversight.
Interesting. For this list and this set, we've actually had more myths than we have recently. But I think the flavor, I mean, how much we like these sets and how much we like the flavor of them really kind of overshadows the fact that it's like, you know, three of the first six cards we talked about. We're like, it doesn't really
feel I mean, good. For every like, you know, three Vorapedes and Mist whatever dragons, you have one like, you know, zombie apocalypse, which again, not mythic, but it still makes me like the set enough that it doesn't the high points matter a lot more than the low points. So
you know, one card I think should be mythic is actually uncommon is the Werewolf Lord. I know he's like part of a cycle and they're all uncommon. But I think it's such a cool ability. Like werewolves never flip back, so you get all werewolves all the time. It just feels very mythic to me. Imagine like In Innistrad, all the werewolves being werewolves all the time feels like a mythic ability.
Yeah, that would completely upset the natural balance of things.
Yeah, it just feels like something very... Well, something has to be great to make all werewolves not turn back.
Yeah, I mean, imagine like in the movies or whatever, or in like, you know, fantasy, like when you have the vampire that can walk during the day, that's super mythic, right? The daywalker. Like, that's the same as the werewolves. They don't transform in the moon or whatever when the moon sets or comes out.
It'll be just like complete chaos.
Yeah, exactly. So it feels like that. That's mythic power level for sure.
So for Paulo, put it on a legendary creature, make it a little bit bigger, increases power and toughness.
Bob the Emerald Wolf.
Yeah. TSG the Emerald Wolf.
And TSG the Emerald Bear.
That didn't take long. there you have it, Hit or Myth for Dark Ascension.
Yep. So let us know if you think we completely missed the boat on some of these. But otherwise, that's it till the next set. We get to do Hit or Myth again. It's one of my favorite segments. So thanks for watching.
Yeah.
That was for you, Butler.
That was awesome. I enjoyed that immensely.
Okay. We gotta keep plowing here. We got a lot of stuff to do.
The bear's gotta keep plowing.
Yeah. You can't just tack a lotus on anything and call it a mythic rune, which is kind of what it feels like.
Okay.
You can't just tack a hockey jersey on anything and call it a TSG, unless you make the top 8 of Austin.